Well, thank you very much, Rita. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us here on what promises to be an engaging session with some of the key secretaries from the government. What we intend to do is to try and get some sense of what the priorities will be that the government wants to focus on as we move towards the new year. So what will 2021 look like in terms of tangible action on the part of the government, where they see the economic revival, and more importantly, what could be the levers that the government intends to use to push and accelerate growth forward. Let me introduce you to our panelists this evening. Dr. Guru Prasad Mahapatra, the Secretary of the Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. Mr. Amit Khare, the Secretary, Department of Higher Education. Mr. Tarun Bajaj, the Secretary, Economic Affairs. Mr. Rahul Chhabra, the Secretary, Economic Relations. And we will, of course, kick things off with a quick opening comment from Sandeep Somani. Sandeep Somani is the immediate past president of FICCI and the vice chairman and managing director of Somani Impresa Group. Mr. Somani, I hand it over to you.
Thank you, Shireen. Shri Amit Khare, Dr. Guru Prasad Mohapatra, Shri Rahul Chhabra, Shri Tarun Bajaj, a very warm welcome to this August panel of the secretaries to the Government of India and all our esteemed guests from the government, industry, our partners and media. With the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, India, like the rest of the world, has been striving hard to emerge out of the crisis by focusing on innovation, devising new strategies, building new skills and competencies, while at the same time prioritizing health and welfare for all its citizens. There have been several reform measures and key initiatives in the last 9 months, whether it is startup initiative of DPIIT, the ECLGS scheme of the Ministry of MSMEs, the decision to redefine MSMEs, the landmark National Education Policy 2020, and the significant agricultural reforms. The progressive policies introduced by our government, major infrastructure development plans, large consumer market, all point towards significant headroom for growth to become a strong economy and an enlightened nation, which will be our inspired India. Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, vision of transforming India into a $5 trillion economy by 2024-25 is driven by the ambition to transform India into a global superpower. Achieving this vision calls for urgent actions on several fronts, from accelerating the pace of reforms for promoting growth, measures to boost private sector participation to bring in efficiencies and competitiveness, make India an export hub, and most importantly, enhancing the ease of doing business. Government of India has been taking several reform measures for the ease of doing business in the last few years. India's ranking in the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business report currently stands at 63rd position. A lot needs to be further done. In this endeavor, FICCI was the first chamber to do significant work and is working very closely with DPIIT under the guidance of Dr. Mohapatra on measures to simplify rules and regulations and addressing ground-level operational challenges of burdensome and complex compliances impacting business, trade, and investments. When we met the Honorable Prime Minister during my tenure as FICCI President last year, I had shared with him the list of compliances that an average manufacturing company has to comply with in a year. This came out to a shade below 2,000 in number. And if some of the sectoral compliances for pharma or food companies were to be looked at, this number rose to 5,000 to 6,000 compliances a year. I'm sure you would all agree, many of these compliances in today's world have outlived their utility and can be done away with, and many more can be simplified. Honestly, when we presented our thoughts on the ease of doing business last year, we were skeptical about how it would work across the government. But this year with the pandemic, we have witnessed excellent inter-ministerial coordination. The empowered group of secretaries was a very powerful initiative to address issues cutting across different ministries in a very effective manner, and we did see great results of this approach. We hope the same level of coordination between the ministries will result in fast-track implementation of measures to improve the ease of doing business. The FICCI Task Force on Ease of Doing Business, which has been specifically set up to look at these aspects, has met several times in the last few weeks and has interacted with DPIIT regularly. Under this task force, we have several working groups led by CEOs in their respective areas. We have a total of 150 people working on giving inputs. I am happy to share that many of these working groups have completed their work and submitted 500 suggestions to DPIIT already. While there is work going on in this direction, there remains key gaps for government to address. Many of these EODB issues would be common across manufacturing sectors. Some of these I would broadly highlight. One nation, one window. Single point of clearance and compliance for the new and existing investors for addressing their needs during the entire life cycle of their business. Two, removing redundancies and consolidating regulations. Continue the work of identifying archaic laws, rules, provisions, and phasing them out. Consolidate rules where multiplicity of reporting requirement exists. For example, under the Environmental Protection Act, there are multiple rules, each requiring reporting and data submissions that can be consolidated. Need to align the compliances under various agencies like BIS, BEE, Quality Control Order, so that it does not lead to duplications. Significant changes need to be made in the legal metrology act and rules, as these are prime causes for harassment in the states. Three, self-certification. Need to move towards a system of third-party certification with accredited certifying agencies. Four, digitization. Need to digitize all the processes and have a single dashboard and digital lockers. Currently, registers under various legislation, the Factories Act, Payment of Wages Act, Minimum Wages Act, Payment of Bonus Act, and many others are maintained in physical form. The DISH portal in states has made returns available online. Hence, physical maintenance of the register needs to be done away with. Five, periodicity of renewals. Yearly renewal of registrations under various acts like the Shop and Establishment Act, Fire Act, etc. is an additional burden for companies and particularly for small businesses. The periodicity of renewal needs to be increased to 3 to 5 years. Alternatively, an option of auto-renewal with online payment of fees may be introduced for such compliances. To be internationally competitive, we need to also benchmark our legislations with those prevalent in competing countries, both in number of compliances and time taken for procedures. I strongly believe that quick implementation of measures to reduce the cost and pain of doing business will eliminate many obstacles for business and industry and fast-track the engine of growth. The focus should be on execution to translate the identified measures to real action on the ground and have a robust tracking mechanism. The current work on ease of doing measures was started by FICCI principally for the manufacturing sector, but this can be done for the financial sector and the service sector too, if the government so desires. FICCI will be happy to support the government in this initiative and will provide detailed inputs. We were very encouraged and motivated last week to hear the Honorable Prime Minister say, and I quote, "Reforms are needed for development. Reforms are very much needed for a new order and to give new facilities. We cannot build the next century with the laws of the previous one," end of quote. May I now hand back to Shireen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Somani, for so comprehensively summing up the ask from industry. I think you've got a little more than half a dozen key areas that you've highlighted which require redressal on the part of the government. And of course, a more coordinated policy action is, of course, the perennial ask as far as industry is concerned. So without further ado, and I will address each of those issues with specific secretaries as we go along. But let me get the DPIIT Secretary, Mr. Mahapatra, into the conversation to start with. Dr. Mahapatra, many thanks for joining us. You just heard there from Sandeep Somani on a whole host of issues that industry has raised to try and build on the momentum that's already been achieved when it comes to the ease of doing business. So let me pick up on the point that he raised on one nation, one window. Now, this has been a stated objective of the government. You have reiterated this promise. How is this going to be different from the promises made in the past? And how realistic is this, given our federal structure?
Thanks, Irene. Firstly, let me compliment FICCI for raising the issue of compliance burden in a very systematic way before the Honorable Prime Minister and before the Honorable Finance Minister in the last year pre-budget deliberation that the FM does with the trade and industry bodies. Thereafter, we started working. But coming to this, and we'll be talking about that in the course of this discussion. But coming to the specific issue of this thing, the way you put it, what I understand is a single window that we are developing now. You know, this single window is a very much maligned word, because single windows have been attempted at many places and it ultimately leads to multiple windows. So what we are now trying, with the FM also spoke about it in the budget speech of the last year, is that we are developing a single window which is technology based. What it does is, for an investor, be it domestic or global, if he has an investment proposal, then it, apart from giving him all the information about land, procedures, requirements, forms, all the requirements to get that investment proposal ahead, he can simply, it will lead to a unified single sheet of information which other approval ministries will draw from that. So he doesn't have to do multiple applications in the end. And this investment proposal will be shared with various ministries. For example, an investment proposal in India would require a PAN number. It would require a registration under the Company Act. It would require environmental approval if it's of a certain size, either state or center. And it would require GST approvals, it would require approvals in the state, it would require approvals in the urban local cell government, for example, for a building plan. So what we are doing is, we are not replacing anything, because these are all important approvals that are required. You obviously cannot construct a building without a building plan.
Sure.
Similarly, you need to register yourself as a company. Similarly, you need to adhere to the environmental regulations for starting any manufacturing activity. What we are doing is, we are bringing all these portals, all these IT systems into one, so that the investor, for him, it is a single window. A very ambitious, difficult, complex task has been initiated. We have committed to the government, including the cabinet secretary and others, that we will be completing this and releasing it and introducing it by maximum by mid of April. We still adhere to those timelines, considering the progress we have made.
Okay, that's important. So you're saying that you will hopefully have this unified window of approval. So you're not doing away with the need for different approvals. You're just bringing it together at one authority. And that one authority is what will coordinate with the investor. But you're hoping to put this in place by the middle of April of 2021. Mr. Mahapatra, let me ask you about the point that was also raised by Mr. Somani, which you alluded to as well. Compliances, sir. I mean, 2,000 compliances annually, 5,000 to 6,000 compliances annually, and in some sectors like alcohol, etc., it's even more. So what's the plan now when it comes to bringing down antiquated, outdated compliances, multiplicity of compliances? Are there any specific sectors where you feel the pain is much more than others, where you intend to prioritize the cleaning up, so to speak?
Let's not go into the numbers, because I myself was wondered where has this 3,000 and 3,500 and things like that have come. But as I said, disregarding the numbers, it is definitely true that there are very cumbersome procedures in certain activities, and more so in activities like retail, hotel, entertainment sector, a hotel with a bar. So things like those activities require multiple compliances. What we have done is, thereafter, once this issue was brought, this is now linked to the, we are doing the ease of doing business work. We have done reasonable progress in that. Compliance burden is a very, very important activity for the government now. The Honorable Prime Minister has linked it to the having a very meaningful and simplified citizen interface activity. The government has now given this important task to every ministry of the government. A very systematic review takes place at the cabinet secretary level, and DPIIT is coordinating this. We have now divided into five categories. So in the first lot to be done by end of March is to reduce annual inspection, or if not, they can be reduced, they can be automated, faceless. The renewals, registrations, data, every data has to be digitalized. all the inspections, all the renewals have to be either be done away with or can be made for a longer period. All the data to be digitalized, the requirement of a citizen to file multiple records need to be addressed to. And wherever reduction in process in these categories is the first lot of compliance burden activities we are doing. We are interacting with FICCI, for example, they would know that we ask them to specifically state to us which central act, which rules they are under, which regulation they are under, which office memorandum issued they are under. Kindly specify that to us, it becomes easier for us to simply tackle that. And we have been, they have given us more than 200 such in the last couple of months. A team is working with them, and we are also working with other trade bodies. Similarly, we are interacting with the state, and I can assure you this has received the highest priority of the government. We'll see significant work, then this is going to very, 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 very systematic, systematic and very, very focused activity we'll see from various departments in Government of India towards reducing compliance burden. Decriminalization of activity is one such. Third party inspection is another such. I'm just giving you some examples of how it is being tackled.
Well, sir, that's the second headline that you've given us on this session. You're saying that the process of renewals, registration, inspections, etc., you anticipate big changes coming in, hopefully by March next year, across a bunch of these categories. That certainly will be good news for industry. We will hopefully get a little bit more time to delve deeper into each one of these as we go along. But let me bring Education Secretary into the conversation. Mr. Khare, many thanks for joining us. My very first question to you, sir, we're still in the midst of the pandemic. In most states at this point in time, schools and colleges remain closed. You know, what is surprising to me is that there isn't enough debate that's currently ongoing in the country on what the outcome will be. Yes, there are those who have access to digital education and digital classrooms formally, but there's a large part of this country that has no access to digital or online education. So is the government concerned about the kind of impact that this is going to have on learning outcomes if this were to continue, the fact that schools and colleges will remain shut? I think you're on mute, sir.
Can you hear me now? Well, thank you very much. Let me start by thanking FICCI and particularly Ms. Sangeeta Reddy and Mr. Somani. I'm really happy that education is a part of the conversation today. Let me continue the discussion that we were having earlier. The reforms which are required in the education sector, you must have read the National Education Policy, but many changes that we are bringing now, the compliance burden that was being mentioned by my friend Guru Prasad Mahapatra ji earlier, for example, in the UGC new guidelines for the online education, we have issued the new guideline that all universities which are ranked top 100 in the NIRF or which are graded as NAC A+, they need not come to UGC for any further approval, and they can automatically start the full degree, online degree programs. So these are the changes. If we have time later, I will come to it. But to respond to your question, digital education has taken a very important place in the new system. And there is, of course, this question of digital divide. But we are trying to address it by three ways. One, that whatever programs are being delivered digitally, the same programs, we have 36 educational channels, and it so happens that I'm also in charge of the Information and Broadcasting Ministry, which has those channels. So we have provided 12 channels to the schools. So whatever a student learns digitally, another student who is not having the facility of a digital device or has some problem of connectivity, they can access the same program through the medium of television. We call it Swayam Prabha channel. So one can either access through the digitally in the class or in the home, or one can watch it through the television. Mm-hmm. The third is regarding the states, because if you talk about education, it is very important to note, especially in the area of school education, that different states have different languages, they have different curricula. So what we have done within the same channels, we have provided 2 hour time to every state that where they wish to have their own program, they can do so. We have also requested the 15th Finance Commission, hopefully once the final decision is taken on their recommendation, there will be some provision of devices also for the economically weaker section. But meanwhile, this three-pronged approach that we are having, one is to provide lessons through the digital media, which we call as SWAM. NCRT has got a Diksha portal for the school children. Then we have these educational channels. And then there are the innovations at the ground level, where many teachers are using their own phones to assist the students. So all three put together, I think the learning outcomes are bound to improve. Mm-hmm. And people get surprised when I say improve, because our country is facing a massive shortage of good teachers.
Yes.
So it is always, I mean, this has given us a great opportunity that we are recording the programs of good teachers from all over the country, putting them on the Diksha portal or on the SWAM portal. The peer review is there so that the good content is transmitted to the student. And therefore, even in the remote areas, say, of Nandurbar in Maharashtra, or say, places in Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh, good quality lessons, good quality content is being transmitted there.
Okay.
I'll stop here.
That's good to hear, Mr. Khare. And I hope that, as you point out, that we will be able to bridge that digital divide. But if I could ask you about the road ahead, you spoke about some of the reforms that have been undertaken in the education sector. The NEP is one of them. This is also a sector that has seen a significant demand-supply mismatch. And the role of the private sector has been viewed with a little bit of suspicion because of the private sector as being seen as profit-making, education not being seen as a profit-making venture. As we move forward, what is the role that you see of the private sector in education? More importantly, what is the role that you see of foreign direct investment in the area of education? And how do you reimagine PPP models in the education sector? The government has also announced viability gap funding. If you could address these three issues.
Oh, definitely. One of my favorite subjects.
I'm glad I brought it up.
See, the national education policy, we are saying that it is transformative in nature. It's not an incremental change that we relax a few rules here and there. It is transformational. One, it offers more opportunities to the students to select whatever subjects they like, whichever time they wish. In fact, the multiple entry and exit system that we are introducing, a student can take a sabbatical for a year, come back and join the system without losing out on the credits that she or he has already earned. Now, coming to the second part, what you raised about the ease of doing business or how the private sector is viewed. Now, the policy now has very clearly mentioned the role of private sector. Mm-hmm. They are not to be profiteering, but reasonable surpluses have to be generated. It is obvious that no enterprise would be able to operate if reasonable surpluses are not generated. A very, very important change which this policy has brought in is to balance the regulatory structures for the private as well as public. Right now, we have differential structures. The deemed-to-be universities have a different structure. The state universities, private universities, and the regulations are different for the type of governance structure. What the policy lays emphasis on is that governance model should be the same, and all institutions should be benchmarked on the basis of their academic performance and not on the basis of the ownership, that whether it is centrally funded or state funded or private funded. I mean, as far as education is concerned, we should look at the output. I mean, what is their perception amongst the students, among the other stakeholders, industry, and so on. And therefore, the entire system will now be output-based and outcome-based, where benchmarking will be done based on the outcomes and not based on the inputs. Like right now, we have a system where we ask how many rooms are there, how much land does XYZ university possess, and based on those inputs, we provide them the recognition. And that standard is different for the private players, for the state universities, and of course central universities, we can do whatever we feel like, not anymore. All of them will be benchmarked against the same standard, and it is possible that many central institutions may not come up to those standards, whereas private institutions may. And that is how the play should go on, that benchmarking will be on academic standards, not on the governance models. A major change that has also been brought in, that all universities, the National Research Fund that we have talked about in the policy, right now the research funding is mostly to the central government institutions. What we have provided for research, and I think that would be helpful to the industry also, that all universities, be it private, state or central, they can have a competitive funding. It's like the National Science Foundation of US, with some addition that we have added social science also. Our National Research Foundation will also have the social science subjects. And they can even form consortia. For example, an IIT may collaborate with, say, BITS Pilani or BITS Goa, also with a state university, and they can generate a proposal. So the funding, which is right now, the research funding is mostly per student or per faculty basis.
Right.
So it will change. It will be competitive. It is possible that a private university may get the funding, a central university may not, if the proposal is not good. So these are the major changes that we are bringing. And let me also, I mean, before anybody raises the question, let me also answer that when will these changes come? You will see them in 2021 itself. Some major changes, if I could list out, common admission test for entrance to all central universities, that is coming in 2021.
Okay.
The academic bank of credit, where through which one can transfer credits from one university to another, that is also 2021. And the regulatory structure, which Mr. Somani referred, even in the education sector, you have UGC, then for technical courses, AICTE, for teacher education, NCTE, all of them will get merged. And in the next academic session, we will be having one single Higher Education Commission of India. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Khare. And that's the third headline coming in from the Secretary's panel. So saying that in a lot of these aspects that we spoke of, the proposed reforms, 2021 is when we are likely to see many of them being rolled out, including, of course, as you pointed out, the Higher Education Commission, which will bring together various different organizations that, or regulators that currently exist. But let me bring Ms. Chhabra into the conversation. Ms. Chhabra, many thanks for joining us. You know, we're speaking in a COVID pandemic context where the world is talking about reshaping supply chains. The constituents of the supply chain and value chain have changed as well. What do you believe will the road ahead need to be from the India perspective? You know, we're talking about Atmanirbhar, which means bolstering domestic industry, inviting foreign investment in India. But part of that aspiration is also for Indian industry and specifically Indian MSMEs to look outside of India as well. What will the most viable route be for the government to be able to aid and nurture that aspiration? You know, we've just seen the RCEP signed, and there are arguments on whether India should have been part of it or not, but we're not, and that's the reality. There are FTAs being inked with many.
I've lost you completely, and even before that you were getting, it was beginning to echo, but now you're completely off. I can't hear you.
Shireen, your
Hello? Yeah, please unmute yourself.
Shireen, your mic is mute. Unmute your mic, Shireen.
Can you hear me now, sir?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. Mr. Chhabra, can you hear me? I think he's muted now. Okay.
I can hear you.
Great. So I was asking you about what you believe the road ahead will look like in terms of our engagement with the world, FTAs, bilateral arrangements. How do we make good of the opportunity that this reshaping of global supply chains offers up?
Thank you. So firstly, It's a privilege and a pleasure to be here on this panel with all my colleagues and you and Dr. Reddy. So thank you to FICCI to organize this. It's a great initiative. But yes, this reshaping of global supply chains, I mean, we are all for it. As you're aware that we have even worked with certain countries to sort of look at the resilient supply chain initiative. So that is also moving ahead. Then the further issues that you raised about MSMEs being on board, I think it's like we know the importance of the MSME sector. We are consciously targeting it, but that's really for domestic industry to sort of come to us. All our embassies, what I can tell you, have been primed up and prepped up to look at opportunities that are available. So through this panel, I would encourage all industry to look at all our, I don't know if you're aware, we have over 150 embassies and another 40 offices. So we have 190 offices across the world. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, they should really be your front offices for corporate India. I mean, you know, people are quite hesitant, I can understand, sometimes from maybe they had not a very pleasant experience and they are reluctant to approach them for assistance. But I think things have changed. We have pushed our embassies to take a more proactive stance. So they are trying to identify opportunities outside. They are feeding it back into our chambers. I think FICCI, CII, they'll all be knowing that they are receiving inputs from our embassies now all the time on this front. So you've got to take advantages of those opportunities that will come up to sort of move forward. So this Atmanirbharta has been explained on many other occasions, but I think maybe another time will be worth explaining once again that obviously it is not an inward-looking policy. It is just strengthening our own domestic capacities so that we are able to play with on a level playing field with our strengths, play on the front foot, so to speak, if I can use a metaphor. So that's what it's all about.
Since you're talking about batting on the front foot, Mr. Chhabra, let me ask you, and perhaps you missed that part of my question because I may have gone on to mute, but what's the road ahead when it looks, when you talk about FTAs and inking FTAs with various other countries? According to the government at this point in time, many FTAs, current FTAs, are already under a process of review. How important is this going to be as part of this Atmanirbhar push to take Indian industry global?
FTAs, we are looking at them, having a close look at them. Just inking an FTA is not a necessary condition to sort of, trade has gone up in with several countries where we haven't had FTAs. Trade has not gone up with countries we've had FTAs. So there's no clear linkage in that sense. There's many studies have shown that. So we need to get into FTAs with an open mind and open eyes, what we are getting into. So that we are doing, that process is going on. So we will not be sort of closing our eyes or shutting off blindly that, okay, we will not do any more FTAs or we will do the FTAs. So if it suits us, it benefits national interest, we will go ahead and do it. If it doesn't, we will move out like we did with RCEP. So, yeah. And it is a call that the leadership will take on the basis of solid advice and evidence, and that's how it will move ahead.
Okay, I'll come back to whether the government has identified any particular geographies where you believe that an FTA would be mutually beneficial for us to move ahead with. But let me welcome the Economic Affairs Secretary, Mr. Bajaj, into the conversation as well. Mr. Bajaj, many thanks for joining us. Let me start by asking you about the state of the economy and the latest pulse check that you've got, sir, because the last GDP print was better than the first quarter GDP print. That minus 7.5 looked significantly better than minus 23.9%. Now that the festive season is over and done with, how confident do you continue to feel about demand outlook? More importantly, investment outlook, that continues to be subdued. We haven't seen a pickup in credit offtake. Do you believe that we're on the cusp of seeing that turn?
Thank you so much. Thank you, FICCI. Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, Mr. Somani, and yourself for having me on this panel. On the economic front, I would say that rather than me saying, I think it has been said loud and clear by the media and everybody around that what was the expectation in the second quarter, the actual results are far better than that. And we are already seeing the figures that we keep watching in our economic division in the Economic Affairs Department is showing that it has actually not gone down as much as was expected by some of the people, that after the festival season we'll see a downward trend. Yes, there would be some blips here and there, but if you find that something is going down, something else is coming up. So it will also depend on many other factors. So we are positive, we are cautiously optimistic on the economic front, and we are hoping that our third and fourth quarter will be far better than the second quarter. And I may also add that not only us, but the international organizations, the rating agencies, all of them have revised their estimates for the country and revised them upwards. And the latest one that came today was
I think we've lost that line with the Economic Affairs Secretary. So we lost you for a moment.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
So I was just saying that we will continue to take all steps that are required for ensuring that the economy keeps going up from here, and we'll see far better quarter three, quarter four, and the next year once we come out with our budget. So I'm sure there'll be positivity in the economic figures that we see.
Well, that's good to hear, and you're absolutely right in pointing out that we have seen those GDP upgrades coming in across the board on the back of the Q2 number. But one of the demands that industry has made, and I think Mr. Somani spoke about that as well, the need for a DFI, sir, and I know that I have raised this issue with you previously as well. Has there been any further movement on that? Is this something that the industry should hope for, or do you believe that this is going to be pushed out for later?
No. Your latter part is absolutely not correct. I think you should...
No, it's a question. I'm not making a statement. I'm asking a question.
But I'm answering it in that manner. So I would say yes. I think there's a huge requirement for that institution. We have a lot of requirement for infrastructure spend in our country. And recently, after the Prime Minister had this interaction with the funds, and then he's having a one-to-one interaction with the funds, and they are giving their suggestions. And this is one of the things that is coming up. And I'm sure in the months to come, you will see some good progress on that front. Let me also say this, that we have also created a debt platform in the NIF for which there was a cabinet announcement. And the Government of India is committed to give 6,000 crores in the next 2 years.
That line is scratchy with North Block. I'm hoping it's going to. So we lost you again on that very crucial point of the 6,000 crore rupees equity infusion into NIIF.
Okay. So that would be leveraged with debt by NIIF, and we'll be pouring in more than 1 lakh crores into infrastructure sector on the debt side through NIIF other than the equity side. So I'm just trying to bring out this point to you, that while DFI is in the works, we are also taking other steps to ensure that infrastructure spend happens and both debt and equity are taken care of.
I am going to pin you down like I tried with your other colleagues, and I got dates from both Dr. Mahapatra as well as Mr. Khare. So I'm going to ask you, when you say work in progress, sir, what should we expect in terms of when we can see the DFI?
To be very frank with you, my colleague is doing that, but I, without committing him to all of you through this method, I would say you should see good progress very soon on that front.
Okay.
So let me get out of that.
you're going to keep it ambiguous, but very soon is the message on the DFI. Dr. Mahapatra, if I may come back to you, sir, and talk about FDI, because we saw record inflows in Q2, FDI $23.4 billion versus $9.7 billion a year ago. Mr. Chhabra was also talking about the outreach program that the government is running across various embassies, trying to draw in investors. The DPIIT and Invest India have been doing that as well. Is there an assessment, sir, of how many companies who may not currently be present in India are willing to put fresh capital into India across different sectors, including manufacturing? How much more incremental FDI is likely to come in? What's your current assessment?
You know, this FDI is largely a private sentiment-driven activity. The way the private investor abroad sees the opportunity in India, he will accordingly invest. So far, all these last 5 years, we have been seeing there's a tremendous excitement in FDI, as the figures reveal. And if you look at even the our apprehensions were that probably because of COVID, it will slow down, but it has not slowed down, as the figures again reveal, both for FDI and FPI. And further, in the defense sector, it has been further been liberalized in the September FDI amendment. So I expect a lot of traction on that that front. Now, coming to the overall investment, what we are doing is we are tracking nearly 1,000-odd companies internationally through various arms, through our embassies, through the various ministries, the project development cells that have been constituted in various ministries, through our Invest India and in the ministry itself, to see where they are moving from just a public announcement in the social media or in the media to where they are actually in the ground in India. So, for example, if a company we heard, say, 6-7 months back that they were planning to look at India, we are now seeing whether they have set up an India office or not. We are also on a monthly basis, we are tracking their entire thing, we are handholding them, we are talking to them. And I can only share with you that significant excitement is there, a lot of activities are happening, a lot of MOUs are getting signed between investors globally as well as in the state. If you look at the some of the MOUs that have been signed in states like Gujarat, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Andhra, a lot of states. I just named a few. So I'm quite excited about it. And then the game changer will be the PLI, the first PLI for the mobiles and the electronics, that where the beneficiaries have already been announced, the beneficiary companies. You will see a whole lot of activities happening, a lot of mobile companies who have started, they have been approved. We'll see a lot of activities on that. The medical devices and the API, which was the second PLI that was announced by the cabinet, they have also done the, they are in the process of scrutinizing the tremendous number of applications they will receive for medical devices and API and the pharma. And the third round of 10 PLIs that have been announced with the cabinet in November, and we are setting a deadline by that by December, all the necessary approvals of finance ministry as well as the respective cabinet approvals for this 10 should be done. So let's see, but we hope to identify the new companies which will be selected under the PLI, all the PLIs by April. So we'll see a lot of activities on that front.
Sorry, you said by when, sir? Companies will be identified by?
Yeah, by all the ministries which are dealing with this new 10 recently sanctioned FDI, PLI.
Yeah.
We're targeting by April, the respective schemes will be notified, the expression of interest will be done, and the selection of the companies for receiving those, for being covered under PLI should be done.
Okay, so for the...
Companies typically will take 3 months to respond to an expression of interest notice by a ministry also.
Okay, so that's the next headline coming in. You expect the new PLI schemes to be notified by April next year is the expectation at this point in time. Mr. Bajaj, if I may come back to you, since we're talking about PLI, sir, one policy which doesn't seem to have moved further beyond interministerial consultation is the policy on privatization, the new PSC policy that was expected, sir. There's been some back and forth on that. We were expecting it to be out already. Why the delay, and when do you anticipate we could see that?
Okay. So today you're asking all the questions which relate to my colleagues, but nevertheless, I'll answer them.
I thought now there's much more interministerial consultation and interdepartmental consultation, sir. So we can get all of you to answer the questions.
Yeah. Absolutely. I can only say to you that this policy, we have a lot of ambition in the sense that we should not do something routine here and something that dies down after a few years. So that is why it has taken a little longer than what it should have taken. But let me, through you, say this, that the policy will be very ambitious, more than what is anticipated by all of you. And I think this will bring a paradigm change in the way we think in the government and the way we do things in the government. And we'll also see like what the education secretary was telling you about the implementation. The implementation will also come along with it. So we should see a lot of action on that. Yes, I agree that there has been some delay and some anxiety all over the place for the delay, but it is because we want to create more ambition in the policy.
How long before you believe that you'll be able to
very soon
create enough ambition in the policy, sir?
I can give you a time, but if I were to move the note, I would have given you the time, but it is my colleague who's to do it. So I'll say it's going to happen very soon. We just had a chat on this very recently. Yeah.
Okay. Just a quick follow-up on that, sir, since you talked about the fact that this is probably going to be much more ambitious than is anticipated. Will this then also include things like banking, etc., which there wasn't clarity whether it would finally be part of it or not?
Let me say this, that what the finance minister in our Atmanirbhar package one, I think this was part of it, she had said that even if it is a strategic sector, we will have 1 to 4 in that and the rest we'll privatize. So I think the answer is there in that statement itself. You don't have to ask us to repeat it every time that you ask us a question. So I think this is something very ambitious and will happen for the first time in India. So let's see.
Well, that's very clearly saying that nothing is off the table as far as the new strategic disinvestment policy that the government is hoping to put out. And as you point out, sir, it's still a work in progress, but it promises to be more ambitious than people are expecting. Let me go back then to Mr. Khare. Mr. Khare, let me get wrap-up comments from each of you because we're coming to the end of our time. You were kind enough to give us timelines of when you expect the next set of measures to roll out for the education sector. If I could ask you, sir, what to your mind is the big concern that you have as secretary to the government overseeing this sector? What to your mind is the big concern that you have that requires to be addressed?
I think one of the biggest concerns in bringing the transformative change in the education sector is the mindset of the people, particularly the parents. Now, if we start a system of 5+3+3+4 in the school side, where we are focusing on playful and joyful learning for the young kids, many parents think that no, teaching of English is more important at the early stages. So this mindset needs to be changed. People think that studying engineering or medicine after 12th is more important than going for arts or for liberal education. This mindset also needs a change. You know, right now everybody thinks in terms of a select professions. They send their students, their wards for coaching to different places. Think as if at the end of the day, cracking the quote unquote joint entrance exams for IIT is the be all and end all. I think all this mindset needs to change because the world has changed very fast. There are more opportunities in different sectors. I mean, starting from gaming and entertainment, I mean, that is one of my favorites, to, let us say, nursing and allied sciences. So this mindset of the parents will have to change. It's a tall order, but I think once the students themselves realize the benefits of going for different multi-sectoral, multidisciplinary education, the parents will also realize the same.
Yes, that certainly is the hope of the millennials, sir, that there will be this mindset change and this mindset shift. And it's nice to hear you talking about gaming. And of course, there'll be a whole requirement of new skills as we move much more towards a knowledge-based economy as well as towards more smart manufacturing. Let me get final comments from you as well, sir. Priorities that you're going to be working on as we head into 2021.
You are asking me or Mr. Chhabra?
Mr. Chhabra, okay. I'll come to you, sir.
Yeah, I think we are really 2021 is going to be very critical. We take over the membership of the UN Security Council. So we will be right up there, one of 15 countries only. So that's for a 2-year period. And that's going to lead into our sort of presidentship of the BRICS, the SCO, and then onwards to the G20. This is a very important period that we're stepping into global engagement, and there'll be a lot to be done by the Ministry of External Affairs. So we are very excited about this coming period.
Well, we wish you the very best of luck with that. Dr. Mahapatra, you've already given us some priorities that you intend to focus on. Let me get closing comments from you and ask you also very specifically about one of the key issues that Indian industry is grappling with over the last few days, the semiconductor shortage. Has that reached your table? Is the government seized of the matter? What do you believe the implications will be for industry, because auto companies, etc., are starting to feel the pain?
What was the last part of the question? What is the industry grappling with?
The semiconductor shortage that's already been seen by industry, sir.
So the semiconductor industry is has raised this certain issues with the mighty ministry and with us. We are talking to them. So I can't comment anything more than that at this stage. But coming to the period ahead, as Secretary of Economic Affairs said, we are quite excited and expecting a lot of traction on FDI to continue, startups to continue, and very, very increased determined emphasis and focus on reducing compliance burden in various levels of government. That's what you can expect to see in the next financial year.
Okay, Mr. Bajaj, I'll give you the closing comments then, sir, in terms of priorities as we get into 2021 for the economy. Of course, the budget will kick start, sir.
Not midway, but we have already started on that. Sorry.
Yes, sir, go ahead.
I would only say that our emphasis is on economy. So we are going to see an improved economic condition in the current year. Having said that, let me say that it has been a very, very difficult year. And for me to land here and ensure that things move smoothly and none of my colleagues feel the pain of less money or less resources, and to the extent possible, we have tried to do that in this year. But yes, this is going to have some jolt on the economy. So our emphasis would be that the next year, we see that how much of the economy can be repaired and we go back to a robust economic growth. Having said that, as a last comment, since I'm speaking at a FICCI forum, I may also request Dr. Reddy and Uday and Mr. Somani, all of you are here, and we are soon going to next week have a conversation with you. The FM is having a conversation with you on the budget. So we would also like to know from you, while the government will continue to do emphasize on infrastructure spend, but unless and until we have the private sector coming and taking the burden of the growth of the country, I don't think we can have a sustainable growth. So we would like to know from you as to what is it that you want the government to do so that both of us can carry this forward. And 2021, we start a new decade, and that decade is the decade for India.
Well, since you're talking about the new decade, sir, if I may ask you a very quick follow-up, because something that's also coming up for review is the MPC framework in March of 2021. What's the government's view, sir, as far as inflation targeting is concerned? There is one view that we shouldn't have inflation targeting at all. The other view is that the inflation target should be moved higher because growth is disappointing the need of the hour. What's your own take? What's the government's view on this?
Shirin, we have to do that by end of March. So the present 4 ± 2% is available to us at that time. There is some dialogue and some thought process that is going on, but I think it'll be very premature and immature on my part to discuss it in the media in the open forum. Before that, I have many other issues. I've got the budget, I've got the finance commission. So let me settle that and then I'll come to this. We will ensure that we have taken care of the fact that targeting has not affected the policy options either with Reserve Bank of India or the Government of India in the Ministry of Finance. So we'll take adequate steps to ensure growth happens.
All right, sir. Mr. Bajaj, Mr. Khare, Mr. Chhabra, and Dr. Mahapatra, many thanks for joining us here to be part of this Inspired India session, drawing up the roadmap for India in 2021 and beyond. Appreciate your time. Thank you very much indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks very much for joining us for this very engaging session where we got many headlines from the secretaries on what the government intends to prioritize moving forward. With this, let me hand it back to Vicky.
So, distinguished secretaries, the Government of India, past presidents of FICCI, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the close of a very interesting session. I think I thank all the senior secretaries to the Government of India for taking time out to be with us today on this virtual platform. You all have been very candid in your views, and we appreciate that, and shared valuable insights on the work being done in your respective ministries. The efforts being made towards reviving economic growth by each department is appreciated. We have been privy to various online meetings, and swift decisions have been taken by each one of you, despite the challenging circumstances we face today. There is no doubt that the Government of India is committed towards reviving growth and taking India on the next level of the growth trajectory. The renewed focus on manufacturing is extremely welcome, with the targeted interventions for champion sectors, PLIs, PMPs, that will help Indian industry to break the shackles of the past. Improvement in ease of doing business combined with the lowering of cost of doing business is central to Indian industry's global competitiveness, and we are happy to see policies being formulated with such intentions. Equal focus is now needed on execution of these schemes and policies under your leadership and guidance. We should not let this crisis go waste. This is an opportunity for all of us to join hands and collaborate for finding innovative solutions to pressing issues and undertaking structural reforms to facilitate India's rise in the global arena. We assure you that industry is equally committed towards the objective of nation building. We have been actively working with the government during the pandemic to ensure smooth functioning of economic activities and shall continue to do so even in the future. With these words, I once again thank all the panelists. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you all very much. Thank you, sir.
We truly appreciate your presence and your wisdom and comments.
Thank you, sir.
It was a pleasure.
Thanks, Shireen.
Thank you, Sangeeta. Thank you.
Shireen, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Thanks, Uday.